should, then we will adapt to change things. So please take the first meeting in that spirit, and explicitly, if there are things which you believe that we can do better, we can take note of those and consider whether in fact we can incorporate that. The first thing that item one is absences, and none have been notified as those who are here, so thank you very much for that. Declarations of interest.
There is a reference to the Barnett Group, and over the period covered by the report, I was the director of the Barnett Group, and therefore declared that as a personal, sadly, not a financial interest.
Similar to Councillor Marshall, I'm current director of the Barnett Group, and the references there have been, but I'd like to declare that as a non-pecuniary interest.
There is no report of the monitoring office.
Thank you, Chair. I'd like to make a declaration similar to my two colleagues, except for my declaration. It's a non-pecuniary interest as my mother is a farm that owns tenants.
Thank you.
I have pretty much the same interest as Arjun.
There is no report of the monitoring officer, and therefore I think we should move to public questions and comments. We have a significant number of public questions and comments. We will take them in order, so if I can invite Mr. Dix to ask his first question.
Do you want the speech first? Comment first? Excuse me. I'm sorry, did you? Sorry, I didn't get comment, question.
Comment.
Yes, she does. Comment.
Yes, for the question.
No, you did. You got on request to speak. Check your email.
Sorry.
That's not speak.
Thank you. You have 3 minutes. I'll let you know as well.
Sorry?
You have 3 minutes. I'll let you know.
Narrative too positive needs to reflect true picture. Doesn't highlight use of reserves. With this $4 million, the overspend changes to an underlying variation of over $500,000. CSG narrative, not full picture being told. The true picture is much higher overspend. Family services net variance wrong. Satisfaction with website artificially inflated, especially planning. Figures don't match those published by NHS Digital. Problems with payments cancel out £2 million. Those aren't my words. Those are the words of the Strategic Commissioning Board, which was held on the 6th of February, discussing papers coming to this former committee, the Boards of Contract Monitoring. I asked Richard Cornelius, interestingly, if he was aware of these issues before the year end. And he said, no, he wasn't, but they should have been reported. You, as a committee, can only scrutinise what you are given. And if you aren't given a clear picture, you can't make the right decisions. I don't think you've got a clear picture then. And I'm worried you aren't getting a clear picture now. I've submitted 34 questions, yet many of the answers show an organisation in denial, scared to be honest. We're in a financial mess, and you all need to be honest as to how it's going to be addressed. Back in February, I asked a specific question about the re-guaranteed income. You said the benefit to the council of additional income under the re-contract is guaranteed and does not therefore impact re's budget performance. Performance against guarantee will be reconciled and published as part of the annual accounts process. Now we find that's wrong. Not guaranteed. In January, former Audit Committee Chair Hugh Raymond said they were referring Genshare to this committee. I asked about this in February. You said these referrals referrals from audit committee will be formally noted at this PCM committee and then scheduled into the forward plan. As we were saying, it has to be pushed to policy resources and will be brought to the appropriate committee in due course. This smacks of pass the parcel. I have no confidence whatsoever in this committee and will not do so until you start answering straight questions with straight answers. My plea to you is get a grip of this financial mess. Stop spinning and get it sorted out. Thank you.
Demonstrating the value for money, particularly for the Capita contracts. What are the kinds of things that you think Capita slash the council should do in order to demonstrate that they are making the savings that they're going to be making and demonstrate that they are providing value for money? Because one of the things that I think you and certainly I would agree on is that that isn't happening, but it's not always clear through the papers. How that is panning out. So, could we just hear some of your thoughts?
I'll tell you what my thoughts are based on evidence. Last year, I analysed 234 capital invoices and reviewed a similar amount this year. And I look very carefully at what you are paying for, and I just don't get a sense that you always get a clear view about what you are paying for in terms of value for money. And there are some real horror stories in some of the game channels, for example. So how do you sort that out? I think you need to take a strategic view as to the role of Capita and REIT and what they are doing with you. I hope that will be addressed at Policy and Resources. I hope there'll be a full and open debate there. My big worry is the decision's already been made. I mean, it's a done deal, which is a shame.
Right, let's move to the questions. Do you have a supplementary question, number one?
Yeah, so my supplementary.
I think the pitch one wants to speak as well, though, doesn't he? I haven't been informed that he does, but.
Did he? No?
Yeah. Did you ask to speak? Right. There was clearly a failure in the system somewhere, but if you'd like to come and speak, that would be fine. So let's do that before we get any questions.
I don't want to take time off too long. What I've noticed in regards to some of the answers to these questions and various other things, is there just seems to be a plethora of committees in the council all looking at the little chunks of what's going on. In the answers to this, to my question here, the questions I asked are pretty much about contracts and the performance of them. But the answers simply refer to Policy and Resources Committee. Now, money is tight in the council. My view is that the committee structure is unwieldy. There's too many committees. None of them take an overall, overarching view of what's going on. So it's just very easy for staff to fall between the cracks and everyone, as Mr. Dick said, to pass the buck. I really think that what the first thing that this council has to do, given that it's quite clear that you've lost control of the finances, is you have to look at how the committees are structured and set up to administer this. And I think what you really need to do is you need a smaller number of committees. That would save money because there would be less money being paid to the chairman. So a smaller number of committees and more effective operation of them. so that these questions can't be bootsed around. That's all I really wanted to say. I don't think it's an unreasonable request that you at least look at it and review the structure of the committee system. I mean, this committee system came in, was it 2 or 3 years ago? See how it's functioning, or 4 years ago, see how it's functioning, and see if there's any scope for rationalising and cutting the numbers of committees and making them more effective. It's not a party political thing, it's just the fact that it, to me, doesn't work. Thank you.
You are aware that, in fact, when the committee has been cut in general functions and the constitution committee are no longer.
That, I think, is a step on in the right direction, but I still think there's too many, and I think the time has come just for a general, overall review of it to see if things could be made to work better. I don't need some reason, but I think any sensible organisation, periodically, and if it's been 4 years, that would be a good